Have you ever wondered how long it actually took the Millennium Falcon to reach Bespin? Or maybe how long Luke was on Dagobah? Sublight speed travel is something that has shown up in Star Wars a few times now, with the most famous being in The Empire Strikes Back, and most recently in The Mandalorian Season 2, Episode 2. Many people realize this is a problem, but not why it's a problem. I see many people that think the problem is that not enough time has passed for the characters on board the ship by the time they reach their destination. I can understand why people might think this, since when traveling below the speed of light, the fastest you can travel is a bit under 1 light year per year. This would mean that it would take 4 years to travel between stars that are 4 light years apart. The thing is, from the perspective of the people on the ship, the trip would be much shorter. According to time dilation, the faster you go, the slower the passage of time is in your reference frame. For a ship traveling 99.98% the speed of light, a 4-year trip would only feel like 5 weeks. You can travel infinitely closer to the speed of light, which would make the trip shorter, and it would also make a trip of any length able to be completed within a reasonable amount of time, from your perspective. The real issue is for everyone else in the galaxy. This is because while only 5 weeks may have passed on the ship, 4 years passed in the rest of the galaxy, and the further the distance that needs to be traveled, the worse this gets. The canon distance between Hoth and Bespin seems to be 1,150 light years. Although this trip could be done by the characters on the Millennium Falcon, and only feel like a few weeks, 1,150 years clearly did not pass for everyone else. This means that either the Millennium Falcon traveled faster than light, or Hoth and Bespin are much closer. It was retconned at some point that the Millennium Falcon has a backup hyperdrive. That's obviously much slower than a standard hyperdrive, yet able to travel much faster than light. This makes sense, I guess, but it feels like something that would have been mentioned in the movie if it was the case. It just seems like such an obvious retcon to explain away a mistake. Personally, I think there's a better solution to this problem. The 1,150 light year distance between Hoth and Bespin was never mentioned on screen, so I would take it with a grain of salt. Things from books, especially those tech manuals and guidebooks, gets changed all the time. A lot of that is made up of filler information that gets changed whenever it's convenient. So until it's mentioned on screen, I would not consider this distance to be set in stone. If we take how long Luke was likely on Dagobah, we can work backwards to determine a logical distance from Hoth to Bespin. We know that if Luke got any significant amount of training, he must have been there for a while. Let's say he was there for 6 months. This would allow for a travel time for the Millennium Falcon of 6 months or half a year, meaning that Hoth and Bespin are around half a light year apart. This is really close, but not impossibly close. Their stars would likely be in a binary system, but would be far enough apart to have their own planets. The longer we assume Luke was on Dagobah, the more reasonable the distance. I once read that before the prequels were made, Luke was said to have been on Dagobah for 18 months. This would give us a fairly reasonable 1.5 light years. Still pretty close, but it's pretty likely that in a galaxy of hundreds of billions of stars, that a few would be that close to each other and not be binary systems. If we say Luke was on Dagobah for 4 years, that would give us an entirely realistic 4 light-year distance between the systems, although that would start to interfere with the timeline of other events. For me, simply saying that Hoth and Bespin are around 1.5 to 1.5 light-years apart, and that the characters on board the Millennium Falcon were experiencing time dilation for most of the trip, is a satisfying solution to this problem. It also solves the problem of Luke seemingly only having a few days to study on Dagobah. While a few days may have passed for the characters on the Millennium Falcon, several months could have passed for Luke on Dagobah. This principle can also be applied to Season 2, Episode 2 of The Mandalorian. In this episode, the Mandalorian must travel to another system without using the hyperdrive, and sublight is specifically mentioned. This makes a backup hyperdrive explanation impossible. The problem here, though, is that in order to avoid several years passing for the rest of the galaxy, the systems would have to be fairly close, and it's shown that there's a third system along the way. Now, we don't know where the third planet, which is, I believe it's pronounced Maldo Kress, is exactly. It is entirely possible it's not in its own star system, but instead either in the same system as Tatooine or Trask, making this less of an issue. The Tatooine and Trask systems would still have to be very close, but again, not impossibly close. Time dilation could even be one of the reasons the Mandalorian was hesitant to take the job at first, since he would be well aware of how much time he would lose. The events of the next episode could have easily taken place months or even years later, so that's not really an issue. Of course, there's always the issue of acceleration. In order to quickly accelerate to near the speed of light, the G-forces would be so high it would likely kill everyone. In Star Wars, though, all ships have inertial dampers, so acceleration isn't much of an issue. This might seem like a hand-waving magical explanation, but inertial dampers are actually really fundamental to how Star Wars ships function, so it's kind of something that we just have to accept. So in conclusion, the issue of sublight travel in Star Wars is a problem, but it isn't the problem many people think it is. Time dilation and ignoring nonsense numbers from guidebooks is really all it takes to resolve any major issues. If you've enjoyed this video and like to see more content like this, be sure to like and subscribe. And thanks for watching.